Will you all join me in prayer once again, please? Well, Father, we just pray that you be here in this place with us this morning. We pray that we can feel your presence, that you can soften our hearts and open our minds so that we may receive the words that you have prepared for us on this day. God, let everything that we say here, that we hear here, and that we do throughout this day and every day be a constant reflection of your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Dear Sarah, the indications are very strong that we shall move in a few days, perhaps tomorrow. And lest I should not be able to write you again, I feel impelled to write a few lines that may fall under your eye when I am no more. I have no misgivings about or lack of confidence in the cause in which I am engaged, and my courage does not halt or falter. I know how American civilization now leans upon the triumph of the government, and how great a debt we owe to those who went before us through the blood and suffering of the Revolution. And I am willing, perfectly willing, to lay down all my joys in this life to help maintain this government and to pay that debt. Sarah, my love for you is deathless. It seems to bind me with mighty cables that nothing but omnipotence can break. And yet my love of country comes over me like a strong wind and bears me irresistibly with all those chains to the battlefield. The memory of all the blissful moments I've enjoyed with you come crowding over me, and I feel most deeply grateful to God and you that I've enjoyed them for so long. And how hard it is for me to give them up and burn to ashes the hopes of future years, when, God willing, we might still have lived and loved together and see our boys grown up to honorable manhood around us. If I do not return, my dear Sarah, never forget how much I loved you, nor that when my last breath escapes me on the battlefield, it will whisper your name. Forgive my many faults and the many pains I have caused you. How thoughtless, how foolish I have sometimes been. But oh, Sarah, if the dead can come back to this earth and flit unseen around those they love, I shall always be with you in the brightest day and the darkest night. Always. Always. And when the soft breeze fans your cheek, it shall be my breath, or the cool air, your throbbing temple, it shall be my spirit passing by. Sarah, do not mourn me dead. Think I am gone, and wait for me, for we shall meet again.
It's quite possible that during the late 1800s, Sarah Ballou would, much like I did this morning, walk over to her dresser and reach in that top dresser drawer and pull out this letter and read it over and over, time and time again. Because on July 29th, 1861, just 15 days after writing this letter, her husband, Major Sullivan Ballou, lost his life in the first battle of Bull Run. He never even got to send the letter. It was actually found in his box that he kept all of his goods in, and was eventually hand-delivered to Sarah. You know, as Americans, we are recipients of a vast amount of love, a love that has been given by countless men and women over the course of our 200-plus years as a country, and a love that was poured out for our protection, for our prosperity, and for our freedom. Throughout the history of this great country, men and women have laid down their lives in service and love so that others could simply have life. And they did it not because they had to, but they willingly volunteered because they wanted to. Our Lord Jesus acted in a very similar way, but a far greater way, in that he gave his life for not only the people of this country or his country, but for all the people of the world, all the people of time, for the very people who tortured him and brought him to his death. In addition to dying for us, he left us some very strong words regarding how we are to love and how we are to act as we become disciples and followers in his footsteps. So if you have your Bibles, let's turn to John 15. Jim just read it, but we're going to go back to John 15, verse 9. As Jesus is speaking to his disciples, he says, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other." When I look at the scripture, I read it, it's just full of teaching points. It's full of good stuff, you know, for us to live our life around. But I felt as though this week God was drawing me to two aspects of this scripture that I want to talk about today. The first of which was that famous line: "Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends." I feel as though this sermon series has been a quest to learn exactly what it means to love like Christ. And so I think this particular lesson is imperative to our study. You know, we want to know what the greatest expression of love is, right? The disciples didn't know this yet, but Jesus himself was in the process of living this out. He was in the process of giving his life for them. He would soon willingly give that life up for his friends. We've already discussed this morning that the fact that so many people in our military over the years have died for our country. But historically, there have been countless people who have given their lives either for the greater good of humanity, or even just to save or impact a handful of lives or one single life. But what does that mean for us as the church? As the church in the 21st century, as an American church, what does that mean for us? Is Jesus saying that if we want to be real disciples, if we want to really love people, then we have to be willing to die? Is that what he's saying? Well, maybe. You know, we're fortunate enough to live in a time and place right now where we literally don't have to die. Dying for the cause is not necessary, but instead laying down our lives takes a different shape where we sit today. You know, a few years ago, this was back when Jessica and I only had one kid, so as you can imagine, chaos hadn't actually taken off yet. It was kind of relatively peaceful. We just had one kid, and we lived in a house outside of Phillipsburg, and we had 2 acres of yard that we had to mow. You guys ever mowed 2 acres of yard? That's it. I mean, I used to mow 1 acre with a push mower, and it took me all day, and it was really bad. But so we had to get a lawn tractor, you know, a riding mower. And I think this riding lawnmower could have been the first riding lawnmower ever made. I mean, it was old, it had seen its better days, but still, faithfully, I would go out every week and I'd get on this tractor and I'd mow my 2 acres of yard. Well, eventually one day I was riding it and I hit a bump and all of a sudden it stopped working. Like the front end kind of broke on it, so it was like and I couldn't get it to start, couldn't get anything to happen. It just died. I said, I'm done, I give up, you win. So I started looking at my yard, and I was I'd mowed about half an acre at the time, and I was like, oh my goodness, I got an acre and a half I got to mow. What in the world am I going to do? I'm sitting there scratching my head, cranking on that thing, trying to get it to start, and lo and behold, here comes my neighbor. And my neighbor shows up, and he's got goggles on, and he's got these earmuffs on, and he's riding this big old grasshopper diesel engine mower. And I'm like, you are the man, my savior. I love you. And you know what he did? He finished mowing my lawn for me that day. You know, he had better things to do. You know, he had worked a full day. This was in the evening. His life was busy, and he was tired, you know. But he came, and he laid down his life for me in that moment. And you know what else? The rest of the summer, he mowed my lawn. The rest of the summer, he mowed my lawn. Which was a huge blessing, because in the backyard we had three apple trees in the backyard, and the apples would fall, and without his mower, his mower just chopped them all up, and like it was just he just drove through it. My mower didn't do nothing. I had to go out there and pick them all up. So it was a real blessing. But the point is that this guy, my neighbor, he shared love with us by laying down an aspect of his life. Now I know that there are a lot of people in this church who help other people out in very similar ways on a regular basis. There are people in this church who give of their time and their money and resources to bless other people. But dare I say that there is more to laying down our lives than just helping when we are available or when we want to. See, laying down our lives means giving all aspects of our life for our friends. Even when we've already given our fair share, even when we're tired, even when we have put in a hard day's work. I think Jesus himself gives us an example of this in Mark chapter 6, verse 30. If you've got your Bibles, let's turn to Mark chapter 6. We're going to start in verse 30. This is right before where Jesus feeds the 5,000 with two fishes and five loaves of bread. But there's a conversation that happens here, and I want us to see this take place. Jesus is in Mark chapter 6, verse 30, it says, "The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, 'Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest.' So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. By this time it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. 'This is a remote place,' they said, 'and it's already very late. Send those people away so that they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat.'" You know what Jesus said? He said, "No, you give them something to eat. You give them something to eat." I can just imagine this playing out. You know, the disciples come back to Jesus. They'd spent a long day. They had been out working. They were coming back to tell him all the work they had done. They were worn out. They had been healing people and spreading the message, and they had been just doing everything that the disciples were supposed to do, doing their jobs. And they come to Jesus and they say, "Jesus, we're tired and we're hungry. We haven't ate yet today." You know, that'd probably be the one for me. Like, "I haven't ate yet. Like, something, we got to do something about this. Jesus, come on now." And they come there, and Jesus is like, "All right, well, let's go somewhere alone. We'll sit down, we'll have a meal together, we'll talk, and you can tell me all about your day." But the people were so excited. There was so much need. There was so much going on at this time. The people, they knew they were going away, so they ran as fast as they could to the other side of the lake to beat them there because they had need. And what happens when Jesus gets there? They get out of the boat, and Jesus sees them, and he's like, "Man, these people are desperate. They have physical needs. They have spiritual needs." And he had compassion on them. And he taught them. He taught them everything they needed to know to heal their spiritual needs. And then his disciples, they're at this point, they're getting angry. You know, they're like, "Man, we thought we were going over here and Jesus was going to give us some food and we were going to have a good time. And now he wants us to teach after we've spent all day working our butts off. And he wants us to do this stuff. We're going to, you know, they pull him aside and say, Jesus, send those people away. Get them out of here. Send them off to another village. Let them get something to eat, and then we'll go barbecue us a goat or something. You know? That's what basically happened. And you know what Jesus said to them? He said, no. You, as my disciples, give them something to eat. See, as the church today, laying down our lives, is being willing to serve and give, even after we've already done our fair share, even after we have put in a hard day or a hard life's work, laying down our lives is being willing to put the needs of the people ahead of our own personal needs and wants. You know, the biggest struggle in the American church today is that we are inwardly focused. We are inwardly focused. We aim almost all of our programs and worship experience at pleasing the needs of the people inside this church. All the while, people on the outside are never hearing the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. All the while, non-believers are left alone, turning to anyone or anything that will accept them and fill their needs. Because the church has shown them that they're not welcome. You know, one of the things that led me to ministry was that I used to work as a manager, and I would work with teenagers and young adults, and my heart was broken so often because a lot of these teenagers and young adults were turning to drugs and alcohol. They were turning to atheism. They were turning to any group that would accept them that they could cling to. You know, it was those groups that accepted them for who they were. It was those groups who welcomed them in unconditionally and met their needs. Met their needs for physical companionship and relationship. Met their needs for their physical needs and, you know, probably even some kind of spiritual needs as well. And all the while, at the same time, churches all across America were selfishly and are selfishly trying to keep Jesus to themselves, isolated within their four walls. But Jesus teaches us, as long as there are people with physical and spiritual needs, then our work is not done, church. As long as there are people outside these walls with spiritual and physical needs, then our work is not done. We've got to lay down our lives for our friends. And we do that by opening the church up, by opening it up to feed the needs of the unbelievers, and by taking the love of Christ to the streets rather than keeping it all in here by ourselves. You know, the second point that I wanted to lift up today and I wanted to touch on was the fact that Jesus used that word command. You know, oftentimes when we read the scripture, Jesus doesn't usually use real strong words like that, does he? He's usually very crafty about how he talks to people. He's very strategic, usually speaks softly. I mean, he has good meaning. I mean, he knows what he's saying. But he hardly ever uses strong words like command. But in this passage of Scripture, in just 8 verses, he used the word command 5 times. He used the word command 5 times. I think Jesus sees this as an important aspect of our walk with him. Would you agree with that? See, church, if we really want to be followers of Jesus Christ, if we want to be disciples, if our deepest heart's desire is to be a friend of our risen Lord, then we are commanded to love like he loved. We are commanded to lay down our lives, laying down our desires, to give freely of ourselves, to work tirelessly, and to focus outwardly. I'll be the first person to tell you, and I think you probably know this about me, that I don't believe that loving like Jesus is an easy task. I do not believe that loving like Jesus is an easy task. And if you're like me, it's easy to get caught up in the world and get drawn away from continuing the mission and the love of Christ as he commanded. This world is deceptive, and just when we think we've got it all figured out and we got things all together and things are running smoothly, something will come around and just knock the wind right out of our sails, won't it? You know, or something will come along and tempt us into believing that we can do this on our own, or it'll confuse us into behaving selfish or having hateful feelings towards others. You know, for me, It takes a daily reminder of not just who I am, but I need a daily reminder of who I was before I knew Jesus Christ. I need a daily reminder of how wretched and how miserable I was, how lost and broken I was. I was a person who had no hope, no joy, no satisfaction. I was a person who regularly questioned if life had any value whatsoever. You know, and furthermore, I need constant reassurance of the magnitude and the repercussions of what Christ's love and sacrifice means to me personally. You know, I just need to be reminded that God loves me and that Jesus died for me. So today, as you go home, I want to give you all something. I want to give you a letter. It's one that is very similar to that that we heard at the beginning, a letter, that letter by Sullivan Ballou, written to his dearest love, Sarah. It's a letter that I hope that you'll take home, that you'll read. Maybe you'll even put it in your sock and underwear drawer. And you'll take it out from time to time and you'll read it and you'll be reminded of the great love of Jesus Christ. Because this is a personal letter to you from the one who loves you. Loves you enough to die on the cross. Church, I believe that when we leave here today, that we really will know what wearing the love of Jesus Christ is all about. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we give you thanks. We are broken sinners who can only see ourselves. We pray that today that might be changed. We pray that you come into our lives, you come into our hearts, and you speak to us like you do. You remind us of the great love that you have for us. And you fill us so that we can have great love for others. Jesus, we want to follow you. We want to share the love that you shared. We want to lay down our lives for our friends. Let it be so.